This is the Sunday that the devil wished you would have stayed home, all right? Because you're going to receive some spiritual download from heaven that I believe has the power to turn a person's life around. And I'm not talking about my ideas, okay? I'm talking about what comes from the Word of God, right? God's Word is what can change us, all right? So we're in a series of messages that I'm calling Reboot. Now, how many of you have ever had to reboot your electronics, right? That is so frustrating. Our smart TVs, iPads, phones, computers, they all need to be rebooted from time to time. And usually we do that when something isn't working right, correct? Something's gone wrong and it's frozen. Boy, that's aggravating, right? You know, you're not making the proper connections. And how many of you realize that sometimes our personal lives can kind of feel like that? Our home can feel that way. Aggravating. Our marriage can feel that way, like there's just no connection. The relationships that we long for and desire can feel like they're frozen, you know, and so it's something's not working right. So wouldn't it be great to reboot? How many of you think that'd be wonderful? And I think that sometimes areas of our life needs to have a reboot. And one of the most important realms of a person's life is in the realm of their relationships, their marriage, their family, even the relationships that you have with friends here at the church and other places. You know, someone has said this. How many of you ever heard this? If mama's not happy, nobody's happy. Come on. How many of you know if dad isn't happy, he can mess stuff up too? Come on. There's another saying that says, happy wife, happy life. And, you know, I prefer this one. Happy spouses make happy happy spouses make happy houses. Amen. Anyway, I just think that God wants what is best for us in our life. And in order for, you have to understand this, that sometimes in order for your family life to have a reboot, how many of you realize sometimes it takes more than one person? It takes more than one person, right? In a marriage, it takes two partners to really, you know, have a spiritual reboot. But I believe that there's nothing in society that contributes more, than individuals who have managed to find for themselves a happy home life and happy relationships. Even if you're just a family of one, you know, whoever you are, you need peace and happiness in your life. And the truth is, you can surround your life with many, many friends and find a lot of companionship in this world. But I believe that a happy home life makes for a person more productive at work, right? It makes for, a more content person. How many of you know that happiness doesn't come from the stuff that we get? How many of you already forgot what you got for Christmas? Come on. Okay, all right, you got something. All right, great. You know, it's January 19th. You've already forgotten, all right? Happiness determines, the way you feel when you're on your way home from work and your attitude when you leave the house. And if your home is happy and your life is happy, filled with the joy of Jesus Christ, how many of you know you don't need to get high in life? You can enjoy life itself. Come on, just tell your neighbor, Jesus is enough to make me feel good. Hello. I want you to understand today that Satan is out to destroy relationships, and in particular the family. There's a barrage of satanic attacks against the family. If he could, he would try to drive a wedge between every single spouse. He'd try to separate children from parents, and on it goes. And if you're single, and we got a lot of singles in this church, right? He'd try to drive you even away from your church friends. In every relationships, there's all these, I want to call them little foxes that destroy the vine. Little things, that will try to undermine your life, misunderstandings, temptations, many discouragements. And you see, what Satan wants, I believe, is he wants people to feel isolated and alone. But how many of you know that God wants you to feel connected with others and cared for? Come on. And that's where family comes in. And I believe that's where the greater, broader family of the Church of Jesus Christ comes in. But we got to realize, man, we got an enemy that's very, very real. His name is Satan, and if he could, he would have every single marriage end in divorce or fighting. He doesn't want to have peace in your home. And how many of you realize, tragically, that sometimes that seems to be the only option in our world, you know, because it takes two to make a good marriage. And I was praying this week for families and for people and for the singles in our congregation, and it just and I was saying, Lord, show me what your heart is for this wonderful group of people that I get to pastor. And I know that God's heart for you is wholeness and health and happiness, and God wants you to find a place where you feel loved and a place of safety and refuge, a place where you can be completely fully known for who you are and also completely loved for who you are. And I realize we've got some singles here today, and you're thinking, man, I'd sure love to get married. And I prayed for you this week that God would send somebody, okay? Anyway, these are all of my thoughts as I began to prepare for this message today. But I want to tell you today, how can you find a way to reboot your relationships, your home life, your marriage, and your family? I'm going to give you five quick things today. And here, the first one is this, number one, and I think I'm starting with this one because it really is the most important one, all right? We've got to learn how to forgive each other. Forgiveness. It has to start with forgiveness. If home life and family is messed up, you've got to start by forgiving one another. Colossians 3:13 says this. It says, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Now, it seems really ironic, even crazy, that we would have to talk about forgiving our wife or husband, kids, parents, siblings, you know, even church friends, because these are the people really that we love, right? You would think that forgiving these people, the ones that we love the very most, that those that are closest to us, that would just come so naturally into our life because we love them. But the truth is, it isn't so, right? In fact, sometimes the people we have the hardest time forgiving are the very ones that we love the most, right? How can that be? I guess part of it is because, you know, these are the last people in the world that we would ever expect to hurt us. These are the ones that we trust the most. We feel vulnerable the most when we're around them. So I guess any hurt by them, you know, in our minds kind of feels like tantamount to treason. Or maybe we're just so accustomed with being honest. And how many of you know honesty is good in relationships? We're so, you know, accustomed to being honest with one another that you know, that what happens is that a part of our true self comes out from time to time. You know, if it was we were talking to our boss or our coworkers, we probably wouldn't have used that tone of voice or that attitude. Come on, but we don't have that same fear at home because we feel very comfortable. So for whatever reason it is, sometimes it's the hardest time we have forgiving the people that we actually love the most. And so I want to talk to you today about what forgiveness is today, all right? And I've got kind of a little list there. Forgiveness, first of all, is a recognition of our humanity. All the humans, raise your hand today. Every human needs forgiveness, and every human has to extend forgiveness. It's a recognition that there's no one that's perfect. Everybody makes mistakes. And so, first of all, forgiveness, the need for forgiveness, is a recognition of our own humanity. And then forgiveness is a chance, number two, it's a chance to begin again. Forgiveness means another chance. So a happy family is a family where forgiveness is easily and often extended. Forgiveness means, yes, I'm hurt, but let's start over. Forgiveness means another chance, right? And so without forgiveness, the only thing that is inevitable that will happen is without forgiveness is that there's going to be distancing, right? How many of you know when somebody hurts you, what do? You back away a little bit, right? And so if there's no forgiveness, you never come back close. And so what happens is you start to distance yourself a little bit more, a little bit more. How many of you know you can emotionally distance yourself from somebody? You can physically distance yourself from somebody. And what happens if there's never any forgiveness, lots of little things and even sometimes some big things are going to come in there and you get further and further away until finally distancing leads to cutoff. How many of you know what cutoff is? Cutoff is, I don't need you anymore. Get out of here. I want a divorce. Please leave my life. I never want to speak to you again. And you know, and that's what the enemy wants. And so forgiveness is an opportunity to start all over again. And then forgiveness is surrendering your right to get even. Yeah. Forgiveness is not saying they didn't hurt you. Forgiveness is not giving people permission. Oh yeah, go ahead, keep on hurting me, I'm a doormat. No, that's not what forgiveness is. God expects for us to have appropriate boundaries in our life. It's not excusing what they did. It's not even saying that you completely trust the person. How many of you know that forgiveness is one issue and trust is another issue? Come on. Amen. Trust has to be earned and even rebuilt. Forgiveness is allowing God to be the judge and surrendering your right to get even. Read a little story this week of a mother who ran into the bedroom, right? And you know, her 7-year-old son was screaming out. And she goes in there and there's his little 2-year-old sister. And she has a big old wad of his hair and she's just pulling on it like that. And, you know, mom realizes what's happening. Oh, how many of you think moms are awesome? Come on. Let's give a big hand for every mom in the room today. Anyway, she knows what's going on. So she gently kind of, you know, gets the little girl to release her hands. And she tells the 7-year-old, she says, you know, she didn't know that hurt. She didn't really understand what she was doing. You know, the 7-year-old kind of acknowledges that, shakes his head. Mom walks out of the room. And the next thing you know, the little girl yells out, ah! Mom rushes back into the room and there's the 7-year-old and she says, what's going on? And the 7-year-old says, well, she knows now how it feels. You see, it's human nature to want to get revenge, right? Because if we don't get even, what we feel like, the other person won. Somehow they got away with it. We don't want to let them off the hook. But you know, if we could just stop and think, when they hurt you, what would you say about them? And maybe you've said this about someone who hurts you. You maybe said, man, they are so mean. You say, they are selfish. You might have even said like something like this in a moment of anger. They're such an idiot. But when you do something to them in return, what does that say about you? Are you mean too? Are you selfish too? Retaliation just makes you even the same. Do you want to get even or do you want to be above? Come on. When we forgive, we let go and we surrender our right to get even. And then freedom is just, forgiveness is freedom for yourself. How many of you realize that unforgiveness just makes a person miserable? It makes them unhappy. It makes them bitter. It makes them angry. It makes them ugly and unsatisfied with life. And what it does is it binds you with the chain to the hurt of your past. I'll never forget the first time I heard someone preach about this. And they actually had physical chains on the platform. And they were saying, you know, you're bound to that person as long as you're unforgiving. You're connected to them. And how many of you realize that sometimes the person who hurt you, they're going happily and merrily along their life. They're not thinking about you. They're not thinking about what they're done. They're at Walmart. They're eating out. They're having a good old time. And there you are, all full of vigor and all full of anger. Listen, God doesn't want you to live like that. God wants you to be free from it. Come on. And that's why we've got to let go of things and let it go. And when that happens, what happens is the chains falls off.